all Tesla news, specifically the Q4 earnings and Model S refresh, welcome to My Tesla Weekend. Despite Q4 earnings showing record-high deliveries, revenue, and gross profit, the stock finished the week at $793.53, down 7%. Compare that to the Dow Jones, down 2% for the week, the NASDAQ, down over 5% for the week, and the S&P 500, down 3.5%. Just a terrible week for the market overall. And then there's GameStop, which finished the week up 235%. And if you don't know why I'm even mentioning that, check out my 4-minute video explaining it. And remember that these are the same shorty shorts invested in Tesla's failure as well. The big news of the week, without a doubt, is Q4 earnings, which showed amazing numbers, beating analyst estimates on many metrics, save for the all-important GAAP profit, hence the stock's tumble. But fear not, intrepid investors. Friday's close only took Tesla's share price back to midday on January 7th. Diamond hands, fellas. Diamond hands. Tesla settled the year with 495,647 cars sold, representing automotive revenue of $27.2 billion and total revenue of $31.5 billion, for a non-GAAP profit of $2.45 billion and a GAAP profit of $721 million. Overall, a pretty stellar quarter and very much in line with predictions. My prediction, published Wednesday morning, beat the analyst consensus on 5 of the 8 metrics I tracked. Tasmanian is reporting that Korean retail investors are loading up on Tesla stock to the tune of $10 billion, which can only help the stock. In case you're curious which Korea, it's easy to remember, South Korea, of course. North Korea would be happy to load up on soup stock. Sorry, North Korea, I love you guys, I really do. But the big news is the refresh, which is milder on the outside than I would have liked, and not nearly as exciting as I predicted, but wicked to the core in every other way. Sure, the front and rear fascia have been updated, and that's nice, but it's everything else that really sets this car apart. The interior has changed significantly, with a horizontal screen that's larger than the one in the Model 3, step changes to the driver's experience with an optional yoke steering wheel with none of the stocks and blinkers you'd normally expect, assuming you've ever driven a car in the last 70 years, and a rear seat gaming system as powerful as a PS5. Plus, you know, it's pretty. In terms of the value, it about matches or beats the various Taycan and Lucid Air products, even those as yet unreleased. In the very expensive category, we see it's quicker and faster than anything, and at a lower price. In the expensive category, it beats all but the most stripped down models, and in the still fairly expensive category, it's similarly right in the mix. I would argue the Taycan is a much sexier car, and the Lucid holds its own, but I'd rather buy the latest and greatest from Tesla than gamble on the Johnny-come-prematurely. And I should point out it's a bit unfair that these prices do not include the $7,500 EV credit, which is available to most purchasers in this price range, except for those buying the Tesla. The Plaid Model S, available for order today and delivery in 2 months, is the quickest production car ever built, with the fastest quarter-mile drag time, even beating out cars that cost over a million smackaroo bobs. With the exchange rate, you can buy a euro for about $4, so I think that's a quarter jillion shawarmas, but you might want to double-check my math. The skateboard hasn't yet been eliminated, but greatly simplified, as seen here, and the tri-motor Plaid variant only looks marginally different, though in very cool ways. The real difference to me is the driver assist features already included, as well as the likelihood of full self-driving becoming a reality on the spec I would order, where I believe Tesla still holds the lead over Porsche and Lucid by at least an order of magnitude. The question was raised about where the Roadster 2.0 is at in all of this, and Elon responded that production will start next year. The Tesla community seemed largely agreeable to this answer, but if I was a reservation holder, I'd be furious. This car is already long overdue, and many buyers have already put down 100% quarter million deposits for a car they surely won't see until 5 years after it was unveiled. That's bad form. Please don't take reservations that far in advance in the future. A quick thank you to all of my 2,690 subscribers who get to see this stuff just as soon as it's out. I don't know who you are, but I thank you for joining me on the journey. Similarly, the Tesla Semi will not be hitting the roads until the end of 2021 at the soonest, since battery supply remains constrained and they can sell 5 to 10 cars for every Semi, and with a vastly higher sum retail cost. I get it, as an investor, but for those customers counting on this, again, it's just bad form. Please let's do less of this in the future. Waymo threw some shade at Tesla over their approach to FSD, to which Elon fired back in his punny way that Tesla's hardware and software is still superior, despite Google having Waymo money. I mean, he's got a lot of kids. You gotta expect some dad jokes. Along those lines, Tesla's full self-driving subscription service may be coming out in the next couple of months, and while it's always been stated that buying it outright would be cheaper, this could be an ideal option for those leasing rather than buying, or those who intend to only own the vehicle for another year or two. I mean, if you bought a Tesla and it's 3-4 years old, and you're looking to upgrade next year, you're not going to buy full self-driving, but you might rent it. Samsung has entered into a Samsung has entered into a partnership with Tesla to manufacture the next-gen chip for full self-driving with 5-nanometer architecture. This is fantastic. And the layman's explanation is that smaller gaps between circuits mean higher speeds, less energy lost to heat, lower power consumption, and with higher performance. A report by J.D. Power, famous for their dogged desire to give Chevy endless awards because money, found that most EV owners plan to buy EVs again for their next purchase, with Tesla topping the brand loyalty chart. I always try to remain non-political, but it's worth noting that House Speaker Pelosi's husband bought a veritable bucket of long-term options on Tesla, hinting that the Congresswoman's husband believes that EV stocks will rise in the future, and more than just to a degree that warrants buying them outright for the long haul. No, he bought options. Similarly, in government news, Tesla has qualified for a substantial battery capacity development subsidy in the EU designed to hasten the transition to electric vehicles. Reuters is similarly reporting the death of diesel looms as car makers accelerate to an electric future. This can only be seen as good news. Elon was asked on the investor call about hydrogen as a possible green fuel alternative, and the answer was as clear and kind as possible: it's a dead end. Apart from the logistical challenges, of which there are plenty, the source-to-street efficiency remains about half that of batteries. While still significantly better than gasoline or diesel, the benefit to hydrogen just doesn't make sense in consideration of the current battery technology, which is mad juicy, even if you discount the fact that everyone already has electricity wired to their homes. Hydrogen just doesn't make sense. In Australia, the land that never sleeps on account of the spiders, I assume, Tesla Powerwalls have been selected for the first 100% solar and battery neighborhood. This is more great news, but the big bottleneck for Powerwall adoption remains battery supply, since in many areas, Tesla still has customers waiting years for their products. Once that's sorted out, the storage sector will boom. Tesla has sued a short-time software engineer who allegedly stole a bunch of data, which is dumb and silly all around, but ultimately not super meaningful in the grand scale of things. But, you know, I'm here to report the news, and this was big news on the week, I guess. And for all you travelers out there, Airbnb.com now offers a third-party service to find Airbnbs with EV charging, since Airbnb themselves remain unwilling to make that an available filter while searching for places to stay. These guys surely know their days are numbered, since Airbnb will offer it eventually, but for now they're up. And based on all these massive blank spaces on the page, and the fact that uBlock shows 6 items blocked, I'm going to assume they're doing their best to maximize return by showing mad gaggles of ads. I'm not about to turn off the blocker to find out, but if this is something that's important to you as an EV owner, here you go, airbnbase.com/EV-charger, who cares? So what big news of the week did I miss or misunderstand? Leave a comment below letting me know, and a big thanks to my Patreons who not only enjoy bonus content and early access, but help keep the channel running. So stay tuned, stay juicy, and I can't wait to hear from you clever robots on the flippity-flop.